they do a magnificent job. They're very compassionate. Water projects, that's another major project that we do. Our first water project is this one, a manual water project in a place called Ajiquito. I think it was, what does it say, so I don't have to tell you. And then, as you see, after it was complete, the mayor gave us a blue ribbon. And they had music, and it was wonderful. We had a big fiesta on projects like this. And then the middle is how they drill, you know, for water in Honduras, especially in Honduras. We have constructed or given money for 33 water projects. The cheapest was 300. The most expensive was 10,000. But you do get more bang for your money, you know, with a water project. It's essential, and it does provide water for many people. And there's still many places in Haiti, which we'll talk about later, that really need water projects. Imagine. And also, here, you'll see, do you want to drink that lake water? You know, that's what people do. This is a water project in Guatemala. And it's kind of interesting. It's a manual one. And if you notice on the left, can you see the bars on the left? That's a bicycle. So they can pedal the bicycle instead of, you know, cranking. Our scholarships. We educate promising young children who have an 8 average, an 80%. We feel that if they come in with an 80%, they'll do well. Otherwise, these children are rural children. They come from the boonies, where even the brightest child can't match a child from the big city, from El Salvador, say, from San Salvador. They don't do well. And I've seen students, like in nursing, we've educated several nurses, and they get very depressed because they just can't hack it, they can't make it. You know? But they do better. They're persistent, and many of them graduate with cum laudes. So we just, that's why we have people on the ground to help and to counsel. And then part of it is the grades, and they're all poor. The other part is they have to give back. And we want them to return to their communities and give back. Now sometimes, if you're a nurse, you can't find employment up in the boonies, up in the hills. So naturally, you have to work in a hospital in a big city. But I feel that they can go back when they visit their families. They can set up health education sessions with the community. And the community respects them because they have an education. And so some of them do that. Some of them develop programs. We have a sociologist that is developing programs now with the government, with the mayor, for the people. This one on the left, Jolissa, is from Mexico. And my nursing class sponsored her and through college and medical school. And she's now finished, and I think her main goal was to be work in forensic science. And she was going to take a course and get that. And the one on the right is a Rarawi. Those are the indigenous that live in the Tarahumara. Tarahumara is the country. Yeah. And we'll talk about that later. I have a story for you. And then we have scholarships in Guatemala. Wendy, bilingual, Sandra, nursing. We have, you know what? Did I miss something?
No.
I guess I did. That's the next one coming up. Okay. There are students that can't go to college. So in Guatemala, we paid that for their education in auto mechanics. And these are students actually in Guatemala that we supported at the university level, and they teach in the literacy program on weekends. Bessie is on the left. Bessie just graduated from the university in business administration, Tegucigalpa in Honduras. There's quite a story there. Bessie was abandoned by her family. She lived in a place called El Guante, the glove, in El Salvador, just a rural area. And her grandparents took care of her. Well, first her grandfather died, then her grandmother died, so she was alone. And during this time, we have a friend of mine, Dolores, has educated her from middle school through high school. Their high school is 6 years, through the university. And she has cum laude. She graduated cum laude just day before yesterday. So she's I'm just proud of her. And the one on the right is nursing from Honduras. And the one on the left with a big smile is in pharmacy. And I had a friend of mine sponsor her, and she wasn't doing well. Pharmacy is difficult, you know, it's really difficult. And so we sponsored her for quite a while, and we said, we can't do it anymore. Well, she did it on her own. And she was married, she had a little baby, and she did it on her own, and she finished pharmacy. And so grateful for the work, the time that we gave her, the money. On the right is Willie and his sponsor. Piggy House is a friend of mine, and she has educated at least 6 or 8 youngsters at the university level. She likes men because she thinks they'll finish. And, you know, sometimes women get pregnant and, you know, they don't finish. But we haven't had too many. I think we've had 1 or 2, you know, so we and then down below is Jose, who was a health promoter in the community, and he wanted to go to college. A really wonderful man. He had 3 children of his own, and he adopted 4 that were abandoned. So he had 7 children, and he still wanted to go to college. He went to college, and he finished in education. And Letty is just a love. She took early education, and when she finished, they sent her to a rural school. You know, when you get out, you're lucky to get placement in, anywhere. And so, of course, her degree was in early education. Now she's teaching all grades in a one-room schoolhouse and teaching everything. And doing well, very well. And Theodoro is, I've known him since way before, when he was in high school. And he graduated in computer science, excuse me. This is a group from, you'll love this, Huitzilapa. That's a tongue twister, Huitzilapa. And that's a village in El Salvador. And they had no means of transportation to high school. They lived about 10 miles from the high school. And the mayor asked us if we could at least provide for a year transportation. So we paid for a truck to take them in to school. And this one on the left that's standing, he went on to college. We supported him on to college, and he graduated. This is a young woman from Panama, from Nicaragua, who studied, she was going to school part-time. And she studied law, just graduated law, and her specialty is women's law. So we have a lot of successes. This is Zulema. Zulema is from Panama, and she was in teaching, and she's done extremely well. Cum laude, or maybe summa, I don't know. Not summa, magna. No, summa is the next one. This is Wilson, who just graduated in Haiti, of course, and he's an agronomist. Now we developed some cooperatives, and one of them is sewing cooperative in Honduras and El Salvador, and we bought the machines for them, and notice they're all travel machines. And a bakery that's done very well, and we provided monies for classes on business plans and how to work with other individuals and psychology, and they've done very well. They set up a little shop, bakery shop, and they have chairs, and you know, the teenagers go after school, and the dates go as well. This is called a molino, and you know, people that the villagers, when they make tortillas, they have to hand grind their corn. And it's very intense labor intensive. And so we provided this. The people line up at 5 in the morning and with their corn. And of course they put it through this and it comes out masa or dough. And so here they go home and make their tortillas. I tell you, when you're poor, you have nothing. During Hurricane Mitch, the rivers diverted. And much of the land was ruined. And so what we did, we've done microcredit loans, and we've done it here with agriculture, and also with a shoemaker that wanted to make shoes for Christmas and so on. And I feel like I'm too close to him. I said, okay.
Is it okay,
Helen?
Okay.
I can get closer to you if you want. And so we provided for, I think there were 8 or 10 men that developed the land, and they were supposed to then take care of their families and sell the produce to the local people in the community. And housing, we've done housing as well. And as you can see, the before and after in El Salvador. That house, the new house, has 3 bedrooms. And of course, there's no running water, so we built latrines on the side. And the cost was around $2,500, $3,000 to build that house, imagine. The difference between El Salvador and other Central American countries, the cost, and Haiti. Now, if that house were built in Haiti, it would cost a lot more. And you'll see that, because of the materials that are so expensive. It's not the labor. And this is Haiti, and you see the house that was built. And normally, they put our name, Gracias Laca. You know, they put that on the front door or on the panel there. And this is Niña Carolina. This is one of my favorite projects. This is a daycare center that we support. And it's really the nicest in the country and what I've seen here in this country. Most children come from single mothers, single families, who would otherwise take to the streets. I don't have to read that, I know it. And what happens is they take their child to the streets where they sell. I keep hearing that.
It's a feedback from the speaker.
It's all right for you. And they take them to the streets, and because they have nowhere to take them. And they jump, families jump from one bus to another selling their wares. And it's dangerous, too. But the other thing is that what happens to a child that stays in the streets, by the time they're 6 or 7 years of age, they stay on the streets. They join gangs and they stay on the streets. So this prevents that. And it's just an ideal place. You can see the pictures, how happy they are, the kids. And also, they have educational experiences. And they have a Head Start-like program for the older children. This is a piñata. I'm sure you're all aware of it. And when someone has a birthday, they have a piñata and everybody strikes it and they pick up the candies. Or when prestigious people go to visit, they'll have one. And this is Sister Isabel who founded this. Now, it really is set up for maybe 80 children. We know they have 125 children, and she can't turn any away, you know, because they'd be on the streets, you know. And the cook, another thing about this daycare center, there is no turnover in staff. The staff love it. And she has to hire more staff. So what we give her is not enough, really. But they go, they beg for food, they go to factories and get milk, they get pasta, chickens. So the food is not a problem, it's paying for the staff. And not only do they have to pay for the staff, but they have to give them insurance as well, because they have national insurance. It's a good thing.
No, what's the youngest and oldest in their care?
They go from, I think it's 8 weeks, babies, they have babies, to 6 years of age, and they're open from 6 in the morning to 6 at night. Oh, it's wonderful, it's wonderful.
What happens to them, though, after they're 6? Where do they go?
Well, they go to school.
They go to the school.
They go to school, yeah. And, of course, this is another latrine program. We sent 10 to this village that owned you. You would come up to the village and you knew you were there because of the odor. Mm-hmm. So it was a dire need. And also, I think Haiti, we have one coming up talking about Haiti. Right. I'll talk about that. Land de la Mate is the name of this. So we'll be remembered, Laco will be remembered in memoriam. We work in the Tagamata, and Jesse could tell you a lot about the Tagamata. But let me tell you a story about the Tagamata indigenous people, the Indians. They can run for 100 miles on just cornmeal. They're great runners. And Nike took them to a marathon near. And of course, they gave them Nike shoes. They wanted to advertise. And so they wore their Nike shoes about halfway through, or even less, 10 miles into the marathon. They threw off their shoes and ran barefoot. So what we do, we started in 2001. Martha Duarte, our board member, who's from Chihuahua, started the program. And we started with food, comida, cobijas, ropa. And in this little town called Raramuchi. And here, of course, we have a lot of sign. We like to advertise, let people know what we're doing. And blankets. So we would really, rather than taking the materials, the blankets, the food, the material also for the women's clothes, we use their own economy. We really try to promote their own economy and buy things there. And so this shows, we take a look at the people, you know. They walk for miles. And here you'll see, this is a water project. We actually paid for drilling a well. But if you've ever been to the Tarumara, you'll know it's all rock, the land is rock. You can't really plant anything. So they drill. I think there's one here of the drilling. I thought there was one here. There's one of the drilling. Well, it broke the machinery. They couldn't drill. So what they considered was providing tanks with filters and collecting rainwater during the rainy season, and that was enough to last them. And here, this one holds 500 gallons. And so it's for drinking only, I assume. And you can see them setting up. And here, you can see protecting what they have, the water they have, the hole that they dug, really. from animals. And this is where the people live. Many of them live right in cliff sites or caves. I've seen them live in caves. Have you been to the, anybody been to the Copper Canyon?
No.
Well, yeah, yeah. The Copper Canyon is where the Tarahumara live. And the Copper, do go. They have Elder Hostel. I went with Elder Hostel. Mm-hmm. And the Copper Canyon is 3 times larger than our Grand Canyon.
Wow.
It's wonderful to see. And they have hotels built right off the ledge. And so here you see, and here you see the water. Usted tomaría esta agua? Would you drink this water?
Is that in Mexico?
Mexico. It's in the state of Chihuahua, northern Mexico. Uh-huh. So that's a magnificent work that Martha is doing. And we also have empowerment of women. How am I doing for time? Not bad. Look, I have 5 minutes, right? We started 5 minutes late. And so this empowerment program is to teach young women that maybe have had a high school, or maybe not, high school education, to teach them skills so that they can go out and find a job or start a business. And so we do that, and what we do is sponsor. We sponsor 15 students in the classroom, kids that would normally be able to pay. This is our Haiti program in Haiti. We've been very active lately in Haiti because, as you know, Haiti is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. And that's what I started this organization for, to improve the lives of the poorest of the poor. And they need a lot. And we work in a rural community called Paraderes. I'm not pronouncing it in Spanish, but it's Paradere, I guess it's French. And we took over a feeding program. And once a month, a nonprofit was sponsoring this to the tune of $49,000 a year. So they didn't think they could, after 5 years, do any more. So we took it over, but we don't have that kind of money. And once a month, seniors and disabled come to this place, and they received, not staples, I would say, coffee, oil, sugar, and something else, but just staples to cook. It's a great program, it really is. And these are latrines. We have, the board was generous enough, right? To provide monies for 20 latrines. I think it was 7,500, but they need a lot more. They have something like 6,000 families, and they need several hundred latrines.
Are these like outhouses, or are they like more?
They're
like
outhouses. That's what they are. You know, you must be young, because young people have never heard of a latrine. Those of us that are older know what latrines are, or have been to Latin America, or these places. I say, yeah, latrines are outhouses. But these are glorified ones.
Where you sit.
I remember in Guayaquil in El Salvador, we had to go out at night, or sometimes we didn't go, we used a bucket or something inside. I tell you, it's a hard life. We had no heat, no electricity or anything like that. But anyway, we have to, and because of the cholera, you know, they're still having cholera, especially in here. They've had, from Baradere, this rural community, 100 have died, and they've had, I think, 1,000 or 4,000 cases. They still have no heat every day. And the health experts will tell you that the people, in order to prevent cholera, that they need a good water system and a good waste system, waste for feces, those two things. And hopefully, we're looking into, you may have to turn this off because the board doesn't know about it yet.